blah, which is bigger than just certain regions. So Malik said, this is how we do things in Medina. And Abu Hanifa talked about, this is the Kufan understanding of Islamic law. When these scholars traveled between the different cities, what they realized is, someone in Medina says X, someone in Kufa says Y, we need something that's bigger than this. We need a source that we can go back to that everybody is going to agree on. We need everything to be rooted in the hadiths of the Prophet. The sunnah of the Prophet has to be the ultimate authority. So, hadith collections from this point on, from the early 800s onward, are only prophetic hadiths, only hadiths of the Prophet. Every once in a while, they'll include a companion opinion, maybe to clarify a hadith, to add a little bit of extra information. But from this point on, scholars realize that you have to be using prophetic reports, hadith that go back to the Prophet in order to make arguments. A good example of a musnad is the musnad of Ahmad ibn Hanbal. He died in 241 of the Hijri calendar, 855 of the Common Era. And his musnad was gigantic. It's about 27,000 hadiths. Now, it's important to remember, anywhere from one-fourth to one-third of that is repetitions. You can imagine that hadith about God descending to the lowest heaven during the night. You have maybe five versions of that in the book. So it's the same tradition, but there's a lot of different narrations. Ahmad ibn Hanbal chose these 27,000 narrations from about 750,000 narrations. But it's important to remember that the Musnad of Ahmad ibn Hanbal, it's not an authentic hadith collection. There's many hadiths in it that are unreliable, that the author included maybe because he thought they were important just to take into consideration in a legal issue, but maybe he doesn't think that this really represents the Prophet's sunnah. Oops. The next stage is the Sunan and Sahih movement. And this is, I think, what most people think about when they think of hadiths. These are books like the famous six books, the Sahih of al-Bukhari and Muslim, the Sunan of Abu Dawud, the Sunan of at-Tirmidhi, the Sunan of Ibn Majah. These are books that combine the Musannaf and the Musnad traditions into one. So they say, okay, we're going to only give you hadiths that are from the Prophet, so that you know that everyone is kind of going to agree on these as common proofs. But it's not really useful for someone to look at a book that's organized by isnad. Okay, here's all the hadiths of Abu Bakr, here's all the hadiths of Omar, but there could be hadiths on prayer in both of these chapters. Well, how do I find all the hadiths on prayer? So these books are organized topically. So there's a book, the first book is usually on tahara, on how you do wudu, and then on prayer, and then on Jummah prayer, and then on prayer of the traveling person, and then on the prayer of, then the next one is on Hajj, and the next one is on marriage, and the next one is on divorce, etc., etc. So these are topically organized. In addition to which, in this stage, the authors are trying to give you books that they feel really represent the Sunnah of the Prophet. So in the Musannaf books, you have prophetic hadiths, companion opinions, maybe contradictory companion opinions. I mean, it's sort of a whole mishmash of all the different information that was going on in Islamic law at the time. The Musnad collections, as I said before, they oftentimes include very unreliable hadiths because they're sort of like the big notebook that a scholar is stuffing everything into as he travels between Yemen and Syria, and he's just hearing hadith, stuff them into his musnad. Hearing another hadith, stuff it into his musnad. And there's probably a lot of stuff in there that he doesn't actually think is reliable, but this is sort of his big suitcase of hadiths that he's later on going to go and analyze. Once that analysis is done, you get something like the Sunan and Sahih books. So two of the famous six books, the Sahihain of al-Bukhari Muslim, are books of hadiths that their authors feel are authentic. They are the highest level of reliability in terms of their attribution to the Prophet. That means that they have the chains of transmission that the authors feel are the most reliable form of authentication for figuring out if something was said or done by the Prophet. The other books in the famous six-book collection, let's say the Sunan of at-Tirmidhi, the Sunan of Abu Dawud, the Sunan of an-Nasa'i, they include hadiths that have unreliable isnads, but the author still thinks this represents the Sunnah of the Prophet. How is this? I'll explain. There's a hadith that says that water, if it reaches the amount of two kullatain, like basically, you know those barrels of oil you see? You know, those are oil barrels. Basically that much water. If it gets to be this much water, then it can't become najis. It can't become impure. Even if, you know, like a dog drinks from it, it's a big enough body of water that it's not going to become impure. You can still use it to do wudu, you can still drink it, et cetera, et cetera. Now, if you look at this hadith, all the different versions, there is no actual authentic isnad for this hadith. Okay? But there's so many different isnads, and so many Muslim scholars acted on this hadith, that it's the practice of the community that guarantees the authenticity of the hadith. Right? So, you can imagine, let's say, I tell everybody, as you leave this talk, tonight, everybody, every night before they go to bed, they need to pat themselves on the head like this, right? Now, maybe no one is ever going to really be able to trace this reliably back to me, but from now on, throughout the Anaheim area, all Muslims are going to do this, pat themselves on the head before they go to bed every night, right? So even though there's no reliable chain of transmission, everybody knows I said this, because the practice of the community guarantees the reliability of it. So when people say that there are unreliable hadiths in things like the Sunan of At-Tirmidhi or the Sunan of Abu Dawud, they're unreliable in the sense that the isnad has a problem. But the author includes them in the book because they say, even if the isnad isn't perfect, the jurists of the Muslim community have genuinely acted on this hadith. In addition to which, I won't go into that, it's not important. Something that's very interesting is people tend to think that, okay, Bukhari and Muslim, who lived in the mid-800s, Bukhari died 870, Muslim, his student, died 875 of the Common Era. Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, Nasa'i, these were all in the same generation as Bukhari and Muslim. Well, once their work is done, really, that's it, right? I mean, we have the Sahihain, we have the six books, we have a reliable body of hadith, so I guess, you know, we can just move on and work on something else, you know, move on to a different project. This is not true at all. The biggest collections of hadith come after that. The biggest collections of hadith come in the 900s of the Common Era, even in the 1000s, 200 years after the work of al-Bukhari and Muslim. The one famous scholar, we talked about him already, al-Tabarani from Esfahan, he died in 971 of the Common Era. His hadith collection is 28 printed volumes. So,